So, hi everyone. My name is Rasmus Michaëlis, and this is my friend and colleague Torsten Lindsø. And we come from a brand design studio called Contrapunkt in Copenhagen, Denmark, where we run a department called Contrapunkt Type Lab. And at Contrapunkt Type Lab, we design and develop and experiment with brand typefaces. And today we're going to talk to you about why we think variable fonts and variable font technology can be interesting and relevant for identity design, branding, and in particular developing brand typefaces. And first, I want to give you a little background to how we work, our approach to type design, as this goes hand in hand with how we look at the possibilities of variable fonts. So at Contrapunkt Type Lab, we only do bespoke type design. That means custom fonts for brands and organizations. And we always try to look at letters as sculptures. So we carefully look at each letter and the shapes and make sculptures that tell a story. Not only the story of the words that they together represent, but also the letter shapes themselves can tell a story of a brand or a company. And there's something interesting actually when doing bespoke projects is that each project comes together with different parts. So with each project, the organization that we work with or the brands we work with are different, they have different stories, they are situated in different environments, and the teams coming together are different, so different people all the time. And this, we think, is a great resource for doing original design. So we always, you can say, build from what is particular with each project into the visual shapes, the letters in the typeface. And we think that kind of approach helps us to fuel more original design and brings that, you can say, that the full our body of our work gets kind of a broad visual range. It brings in diversity. And we believe diversity is good for all of us on many levels and also within type design. And we mention this because we see a different tendency when we look around, at least looking at some of the big global brands that many of us interact with in our everyday life. And we see this tendency that to not maybe look so different. And there might be, you can say, many different arguments, strategic arguments for why this turn or this direction. But on a, you can say, personal but also professional level for Torsten and I, we find this a bit uncanny or scary even. And one thing is on the logo level, because we all know that the logo only means so much today, and many people even say that the logo is dead, but it actually goes even deeper into, you can say, interface level as well, where you can see in these examples of interfaces here that there are actually very few elements at play, and typography plays a big role. And so diversity in type design could, you can say, mean a lot actually also on this level. So just to show that we think that we strive for not, you can say, fueling this tendency or to drive to get visual, you can say, diversity, we go about that quite practically in our work, and Torsten is going to give you some examples of how we do that.
Yes, thank you. Okay, so if we want to create, you can say, bespoke typefaces that we mean have a distinguished design, we need to kind of map some methods of how to do it. And I can say for myself, I'm a craftsman, so we do this very practically. So every time we have a new project, we always see what is unique to this project, because every project or every client have, how can you say, some source material that is unique to them. And I would say a very interesting thing for us here is that it forces us as type designers to take starting point in something else than the type. So we can lift ourselves from the conventions or traditions of type design that will always come later when we need to produce the fonts anyway. But what we do is we try to find something unique about the client. And that could be, for example, the setting or the context. It can be a historical reference, or it can be so many different things. And to show you how we work, I want to just briefly show you two different examples with two different approaches. And the first approach is a bespoke typeface we did for Noma. And Noma is a Danish restaurant in Copenhagen. And Noma is shortened of Nordisk mad, meaning Nordic food. So that's a very, you can see we look at the ingredients. So what the Noma does is food, exclusive food based on local ingredients, very much in tune with the nature. It's also represented in the restaurant as well. So what we want to do is a typeface that, just like Noma, is inspired by the organic shapes of the nature. So it's not that intellectual, it's very hands-on in a way. And as Rasmus also said in the beginning, we look at each glyph as a sculpture. We are very interested in like looking at the letter shapes as different sculptures that can have a unique, you can say, expression to them. So we even have something that looks like, for example, the furniture in the restaurant. So one thing is the sculptural level, but it also, of course, has to turn out to be a harmonic typeface. We use this way of working because it fuels us to create type designs that could, at least we would say, that can be memorable and that people can recognize. And I don't think Noma would be happy to be called a brand, but it becomes a part of the Noma visual identity, you can say, this typeface. Another example I want to show is another approach, which could be using the logo as a typeface. And of course, that only makes sense if we work with a client or a collaborator that has a logo which is significantly widened and that people know. And an example of that could be the A6 Tiger, which it's 2 years ago, I think they need to revitalize the A6 Tiger brand, so people could separate it from the A6 running shoes and the A6 street shoes, the lifestyle shoes. And if we had to look at something that was very recognizable from the old A6 Tiger, it's the old school Herb Lubberlin logo that most of us know. So if we wanted a typeface that could be very kind of oozing of A6 on every touch point, it would make good sense to just take the logo and cut them into pieces and start creating letter shapes from that. The logo, as you can see, is very geometric. So very quickly we can come up with a typeface. And you can say here we don't look so much at legibility or small point sizes, but for this particular project that was not really important. Here it's about recognizability and you can say impact. And it really fuels us because here we can work with the sculptural element on a new level that you can say the letters become a part of the both merchandise but also a sculpture in the shop, for example. So I think these are important to show before we get into the whole variable font thing, because this is the way we work, this is how our projects are fueled, it's always based in the context. Yes?
Okay, so now we get to where the variable fonts come into play here. And we want to kind of ask ourselves, okay, so where do variable fonts fit into our approach? And we want to answer that by telling about a concrete project, a project that we did together with our good friends at Nippon Design Center in Tokyo, Japan, where we made a typeface for a Chinese audio technology company called Goertek. And so Goertek, they are a company that makes audio technology, you can say software and hardware, so everything from algorithms to components that go into everything from speakers to audio variables. And they were building a new research and development facility in Qingdao in China. Oh, they are building it, it's not built, finished yet. And Nippon Design Center was commissioned to do identity for this facility, wayfinding and signage. And we were then partnering up to do a typeface for this project as well. So we, as we always do, try to look at what parts of the Goertek brand, what the story that goes around Goertek, could we use as a kind of visual driver for our designs. So we of course, were through several, you can say, different concepts, but we settled on the visualization of sound and audio as a wave, as a visual driver. And then we very simply said, okay, then if we were to take the visualization of sound as a wave and then combine it with letter shapes, we would get something like this E with a wave in the middle. And then it's very important to say that at this point, we were not doing variable fonts. We were still thinking as a static font. So when we had this, we said we can work from this. So then we imagine it as a family with different weights. We go from light to bold. We can also go to have a hard wave. We can have a soft wave. And so these were different weights that you could pick and choose. So if we have some sketches here from the, you can say, implementation. So it could shift between different instances here. But the thing is, at this stage, we are still kind of, you still had to pick and choose. So when you were to implement and unfold this design, you would still have to choose, okay, on this sign I would like to have the soft wave, or the other sign I would have the neutral, or on this I want the hard wave. But the thing is that actually when, yeah, we had to put this, slide in, because I was always surprised when the video started. So, so actually when we were presenting this project and talking to the client, we were always visualizing this with animation. Going to show you here.
Hello.
This was a part of the process to presenting the concept, and it is not done as type, it is animated. And it was kind of an inner struggle for us, actually, that we couldn't really unleash what we had imagined. But then something amazingly happened.
Which you might already have guessed. I think we had already, as Rasmus showed with the static instances, we could, in a, what we say, a poetic way, translate sound waves as a driver into the fonts. But you can say we had to just embrace the luck that when we were working on the Goertek project together with Nippon Design Center, we followed Twitter and Instagram and everything just like you do, and everything was just flooding over with this new open type feature. So it even hit us in Denmark. And everyone was talking about variable fonts. And we had, Rasmus and I and the other designers had been talking about, we really want, if we want to represent sound and we want a wayfinding system that reacts to sound or reacts to its surroundings, we need to almost put a mic into the letter. We want the letters to be dynamic in a way. And we could see how this variable font technology could solve this problem for us. So you can say, we wanted to go from here to here. So if you both could have something that moves or maybe even could react to sound, or it could be any parameter, but in this case, sound. So, of course, like everyone else, we started to play around with this new technology, you can say. Different variations with different inputs and see how we could apply it maybe to Chinese characters or Japanese characters.
So, actually, what is interesting here, actually, that we go, there were several, you can say, for us, at least several revelations that before we were thinking in, you can say, static instances, weights that you have to choose. Suddenly, we're actually designing not only the specific instances, but actually designing everything in between the axes. So we're actually designing the movement when we, you can say, interpolate between the axes. So it's a new way of actually designing brand typefaces that are dynamic. But one thing is actually designing this, you can say, movement or this interpolation. Another thing is actually what makes it move also. So without we are actually designing a span that can move, but if you also think into the brand story, what makes it move? In this particular case, we were talking about the audio could make it move, so we're putting a microphone into the typeface. But we can imagine, you can say, endless ways of using sensors to, you can say, make us move on this axis, for example. So what we are talking about a lot about in our little type lab is that we want to expand much more with what makes us makes the axis move. For example, we can imagine not only sound, but maybe pollution. A sensor that picks up pollution in the city makes the letters of the street signs change over time, or many different ways. So there's so many things also that Marlene also told that there's so much more to explore, and this is really fun, we think.
Yeah. You can say when we have showed this concept and how we develop it, you might think, at least I think, show me the money, I want to see how this work on the signage, how does it look in the building? And you can say, we are waiting too, because I think this building is done in something, is it 2023 or something like this. So there will be a lot of development time. But of course we had tested how does it look in different graphical environments. And I'll just allow us to just show you. Oh, it's a mix here. How it looks when it actually reacts to sound. So on this German computer, I will
Chrome, you know.
Yeah.
Chris. Oh, I think it was it.
Okay, so the idea is here that we have you could say a variable font actually. Ah, okay. Can we change? Oh, okay. Here it comes. Oh, I think it's fine. No, I will just do it from here. Oh, it's pretty hard for me to see here. Sue Larsen. Thank you. So you can see that now it actually we have an input that which right now is just me talking. but actually the letter shapes it react to its surroundings now. So you can see in principally it works.
So maybe you could all of you help us make it move. So
that was cheap.
Okay, you maxed it out, so just almost still still though. So actually we think that this is, even though it's not implemented, it shows some of the potential for taking typefaces and make the surroundings interact with them, the surroundings and even humans. So we think this outlines, at least for us, an exciting new, you can say, way to interact with the type and the brands that the type that we do represents.
Yeah, I could add that we are always looking for new methods to, how can you say, unfold our storytelling within typeface design. And that's just why this variable font technology is really compelling to me. Yeah.
So on that note.
Thank you.